Hello, greetings. Terry here from handmadehope.com. It's been quite a year, and it's been quite a while since I made a post on my blog. So this blog's going to be a little different. This is my first attempt at really doing a video blog, and I had been thinking about this blog post now for quite a while. Decided a video blog would really be up close and personal. My first purpose is to reach out to all those friends and family, both old and new, that have been wishing me well over the last few weeks. And I also wanted to use this video as a way of sharing the impact that Bulletproof Radio has had on my life. I first bumped into Dave Asprey and Bulletproof Radio in the summer of 2013. I had been working decades in the restaurant industry, very, very hard, and all of a sudden, my body was just screaming. I could not do the work that I had been able to do. I had so much pain in my hips and my joints. I had a lot of muscle spasms that would just start running up and down my spine and my legs and just render me unable to even walk. I was really in a quandary and thought, well, this is the price you pay for getting old and, the abuse your body's taking over the years. Well, I happened to catch an interview that Jan Irvin had with Dave Asprey. I was listening to the interview, and all of a sudden some light bulbs went off, and I thought, boy, I don't have anything to lose but to try this. So I immediately did two things. I eliminated gluten, and I began drinking coffee with butter and MCT oil, or coconut oil at first. I didn't have the MCT oil, but I soon got some. I was astounded because within a week, the spasms had stopped, and I was feeling so much better immediately that within a week that I was convinced that, okay, This is awesome. And I went full boat. I signed up and listened to Dave's presentation on the Bulletproof Lifestyle that he did as a webinar. And I studied, and I went back to Bulletproof Radio, and I listened to as many episodes as I could cram into my day. Soon I was back to work, and it was amazing. My brain was alive. I was able to keep up like nobody's business. Within 3 months, I had dropped 50 pounds. I had lost all the inflammation, and I was really, really rocking it. And continue to rock it. So Bulletproof became an enormous part of my life right away. In fact, I really feel like the Bulletproof Radio is an extended part of my life and my family. It feels like family to me. And I'm always there learning something. 2014, just about a year ago, I started handmade-self.com kind of on a lark because I was really enjoying this biohacking hobby. I kind of approached it very seriously and passionately, but more like a hobby. It was something I did, and everybody around me knew of my little biohacking things that I was learning, and I'd often share with them and have them try things. At one point, I was using the heart math and wave probe to really make sure I was in coherence with my heart. I'd always been a meditator. I'd been doing focused breath work and meditation work for several decades, actually. So I had brought those skills to the table when I first found Bulletproof Radio. But implementing and these little things throughout the year, as I could, just was a lot of fun. And very informative and rewarding. You know, I got the Bulletproof sleep mat and was sharing it with people and letting them try it out. And, I tried the Unfair Advantage and really loved it. So I started getting on the Unfair Advantage to feed my mitochondria. I was taking the upgraded aging formula to, protect my brain, and all these things were really making me feel different. It truly was amazing. We had gone as a family too, had really changed a lot about how we were living our lives. My daughter spent the summer and turned our yard into this amazing garden, a food garden. And we had fresh food from our little urban garden right here in Charlottesville, Virginia. We had the great pleasure of overhearing neighbors walking with their children and describing just a few weeks ago, okay, look at this lovely winter garden, and saying they had Brussels sprouts and kale and all these things we have growing in our front yard, and watching the toddlers run over and grab a leaf and taste it. The rewards and pleasure of knowing that not only are you reaping the benefit of growing and having your hands in the soil and connected to the food we're eating and consuming, but also now, by extension, our neighbors as they walk by our yard. I find that very rewarding. And I'm really thankful and grateful that my daughter spent so much time and energy to make that happen. These little hacks fell into our year pretty regularly. So 2014 was certainly a remarkable bulletproof year. In our household, we had accomplished a lot in the way of hacking our home. On December 7th, I was at work as usual, but I was just feeling off, and I'd had a couple days where I had some things that were going on with my body that just didn't feel right, and I wasn't quite sure what was going on, but I was paying attention. And I got off work at 4 and headed to walk home. I have about a 12 to 15 minute walk one way. And gee, you know, I got about a block away from the restaurant and I had to sit down. I just was feeling so weird, and immediately, I went into my breath work, and immediately I was working to do the coherent breath work and get my, I wanted to feel that coherence that I had learned to recognize in my body. So I sat there for a while and did my breathing until I felt like I could walk a little bit more. And I continued on my way and got about a block away from my house and had to sit again. And so I sat down and again went into my breath work and brought, as best as I was able, brought my breath and my heart back into some kind of coherence. That's what I was attempting to do. And I think I must have done it because I did manage to walk that last block home. But as I sat there in that state of coherence and in that state of mindfulness and touch with my body, I knew right then and there, without a doubt, I heard my body and I said, nope, you're going to get home and you're going to the hospital. You're going to go be seen. So that's what I did. Went into urgent care and who immediately called an ambulance and transported me to the hospital. So apparently they were checking my blood and it showed up in the enzymes that there might be some heart damage. So perhaps I'd had a heart attack. Well, I have my family has a very, very powerful and strong history of heart disease and on both sides. A lot of heart problems in our family. And I really felt as I was being taken into the hospital that, oh my goodness, okay, here it is. It's my turn, you know. I'm the eldest of four sisters, but I know my other sisters have dealt with high blood pressure and some of them have blockages, and this was something that was in the back of my mind, and I thought, okay, you know, genetics, let's see what, you know, maybe it's not going to do any good being bulletproof. Maybe the damage has been way too long gone, you know. But they did the heart catheter, and there was no blockage, no blockage in my heart at all. So then they decided they wanted to do the brain studies and make sure I hadn't had a stroke, because I'd had some neuropathy in my fingers and little concerns. So they did the heart echocardiogram, they did the brain scans, they did all of that, and everything was looking fine. And then on Monday, while I was in the hospital, waiting to one of these tests the next day, I already had the heart catheter, awaiting the next test. On December 8th, my heart went into chaos. It went through an electrical event that just threw it absolutely into chaos, and I coded and I died, and for 3 minutes I was gone while they pounded on my chest and found the defibrillator, and then I was back. It was interesting coming back to the awareness with such clarity that, and it was with supreme clarity. As I came back to consciousness, I believe I said, I coded, didn't I? And somebody said yes. And the thought went through my head, you were dead, and now you're not. And I asked them to call my daughter. It was a supremely clear moment. It wasn't frightening, but it was a supremely clear moment that I had been dead and now I was not. And I'm very grateful to be able to tell you, just sit here and tell this story. Because if I had not been where I was when this happened, in the hospital already, there's a very good likelihood that I wouldn't be here at all. 90% of the people that go through the kind of electrical event that my heart went through in that moment don't live. They don't make it. I'm one of the 10%. Very few lucky people that was in the right place at the right time and was healthy enough to withstand the trauma. When I came out, when I came back to consciousness, and as the doctors began to try to figure out what was going on, they soon discovered that everything checked out good. My brain was fine. My circulation was fine. My muscle tone was fine. My arteries was fine. I had no heart disease. There was an unknown reason for this electrical event to happen in my heart. And it may well be they're thinking a genetic tendency that they're looking at now, because it seems to happen in my family, usually around 40 years old or 62, that there these electrical events happen and generally claim the life of the family member. So I'm now part of a genetic study to discover that. Long story short, before I left the hospital, I ended up with a biohack that I had never ever really considered getting. I got one of these installed. This is a updated version of what used to be called a pacemaker, only it does more than just pace my heart now. I have it installed. Isaac, I've named it. This is Isaac. It's installed just under the skin, right here. I won't gross you all out and show you that. It's about the size of probably a mouse or so. And the leads coming out of the device are wired down into my heart. And so it can deliver therapies, electrical shocks, or pace your heart. But it also is like a permanent EKG monitoring system too. So I came home wired and fully biohacked now. It's been interesting. We'll talk more about that as I get used to what this means in my life. The amazing thing is that I'm living here in a time where this kind of data may not, I may never need the device. I mean, I may never have another event like that happen. Let's hope not. If I do, it has the capacity to deliver that electrical shock to restart my heart and bring it back into coherence. But the really big and exciting thing I think of is that it takes all this data in and then transfers it into those doing research. So even if I don't need the device ever and live a long and healthy natural life, that data gets collected every 3 months or so and will likely help us understand these kind of events and the genetic parts of it that will perhaps enable us to learn which genes are the ones responsible, which ones we can turn off and turn on. The whole field of epigenetics comes to mind here. And so we're right back at Bulletproof Radio. I really had no intention of taking my biohacking to this level, but I'll tell you one thing. I'm extremely and profoundly grateful that I had a year and a half of working towards becoming bulletproof and resilient before I went through this experience. I tell you, I'm really glad whoever pounded on my chest for 3 minutes did so, but it hurts. I'm really, really glad that all those measures used to keep me alive were used, but they're trauma to the body often. And gee, I'm glad I have the resilience to bounce back quickly. It wasn't long before I was home, walking around the block. I'm back to pretty much caring and doing whatever I need to do except raise this arm up for the next 3 months while those leads get firmly attached to my heart. I'm really, really, really grateful to have had the year at Bulletproof Radio that I've had as a background coming into this experience. So you can see Bulletproof Radio means an awful lot to me. And it has become a part of my family. And hopefully, I'd like to think that this might inspire you to take a look and make it a part of your family. You know, I now have a primary care physician for the first time in 30 years. And I have my first appointment this week with him. And this is what I'm taking him. I'm going to take him a copy of this book and one other. Yep. First book he's going to get is The Bulletproof Diet, because my doctor's got to know what page I'm on. And once he knows, I'm sure he'll be on board too. Otherwise, I'll fire him. It's been a very merry holiday for me here, because I am here. I'm very fortunate to be here. And without a doubt, I would not have come through this experience with the resilience and strength that I have had I not been bulletproof. It's hard for me to pick one podcast to talk about, But I went through some of the podcasts and I chose a podcast that I'd like you to listen to. It's a podcast, actually it's one where Dave isn't doing the interviewing. It's another part of the Bulletproof family. Zach, who interviews Pedram Shojai, Dr. Pedram Shojai. And I chose this podcast and episode for several reasons. I think it really showcases some of the core and important parts of not just my story, but a good place to begin and why to begin there and why to make this these choices at a core level. It's only about 40 minutes, so take a listen to the podcast. He talks about how our origins and living in today's environment affects us and what we can do to grab hold and control the stress in our lives and bring us back to the garden. I really would love you to listen to the podcast and listen to the end, because at the end where Pedram is asked the top three things, I'd have to say it'd probably be the top three things on my list right now. I'm taking his advice at heart, to heart. We've already done the community garden, or community. We've already done and implemented number one. Getting connected to our food. Number two meant the difference between life and death for me. And that was the mindfulness to hear my body, hear what it needed, and be here now and respond in the now. And number three, I plan to embrace with a whole new level of passion and purpose, and that's to live my dream. I'd like to take a quote out of this podcast, because as I came back to consciousness on December 8th with this knowledge that you were dead, and now you're not. There's this kind of awareness and purpose that arises in me and understands that, as Pedram so eloquently says it, the universe asks us to move. I just work here. Well, I'm still here, and the universe is asking me to move, and I'm going to show up. I hope that 2015 brings to you and your family all the joy and all the passion for life that I feel right now. I'm a very, very lucky lady, and I'm very happy that I'm here to tell my story, and I hope it makes a difference in your life. So, listen to the podcast. Tell me what you think. I'd really love to hear what you have to say. If you have any questions about my recovery, about some of the things that you might be wondering about, don't hesitate to leave a message or leave a comment. Definitely be in touch.